week of the course, I will be talking about two French social scientists. As you remember, last week I talked about two German social scientists. Today, I am going to talk about two French ones. Now, these are contemporary, actually, from 1920s onwards. They lived both. They are born in 1924, Lyotard, and 25, Gilles Deleuze, and Félix Guattari is younger. I am taking up Deleuze and Guattari together because the work that I will focus on, two works, Anti-Oedipus and A Thousand Plateaus, these two books are written together. So these two I consider as one author, although they are two of them. Okay, so 20s they are born, and 90s during 90s they passed away. So most of 20th century, I would say. Okay, now they have some similarity. Now they are very critical of modernity and previous theories, epistemologies and ontologies. In a sense, they ushered a new period together with, of course, others like Foucault. Of course, we have to think of Foucault as well. And in a different sense, Bourdieu in French social sciences. These thinkers, Lefebvre, these social scientists contributed to the development of a new phase of sociology and social sciences. And interestingly, Jean-François Lyotard, like Bourdieu, was in Algeria at one point. He was a teacher in a city in Algeria. Constantin is a city there. And he says, for example, I owe my awakening to Constantin. And what does that mean? being in Algeria gave him Jean-François Lyotard and Pierre Bourdieu a critical perspective while observing non-European, non-French society, Algeria, and looking back at their own societies critically from the perspective of another society, a society which was a colony subordinated to the French power, French imperialism. Now, both of these social scientists and others like Jean-Paul Sartre supported Algerian war of liberation against their own country, against France, because they thought that colonialism, imperialism is wrong, and hence in Algeria should be an independent country. Although many people in France criticized them because they are not supporting their own country, their own army, but on the contrary, they are supporting FLN. FLN is Front Liberation Nationale, that's the French National Liberation Front in English. So Lyotard supported this movement in Algeria. Now, his impact, his contribution to social sciences, a critical approach to social sciences, started actually in his first book, Libidinal Economy. That's translated into English in 1993 and into Turkish in 2011. But his impact came from his next book, actually, published in 1979, The Postmodern Condition, which is translated into English in 1984 and into Turkish in 2014. Turkish's Postmodern Durum, Bilgi Üzerine Bir Rapor, Postmodern Condition, a report on the condition of knowledge in the world during 70s and 80s. Now, his diagnosis of the condition of knowledge, science, technology in now or already in late modern period, or he called it postmodern period, was such that knowledge production, scientific research, technology development is not anymore a pure academic practice. It is not just academic practice. On the contrary, these activities, these intellectual, scientific activities are commercialized, they are not just production of knowledge for knowledge, but production of knowledge, scientific knowledge for technological implementation industry. Okay, that connection existed before too, but this development, the development for the development of knowledge, contribution to knowledge for the sake of knowledge, and that is the debate, or for its implementation in industry, in economy, in society. Of course, knowledge is produced so that it will be applied, implemented, used for the benefit of people. Now, in modern condition, that was the situation, Lyotard observes. But in postmodern condition, it is not limited to that anymore. Knowledge become commercialized. Now, knowledge is being produced not for the sake of applying to societal needs, but now it is produced for exchange. It is being bought and sold. Knowledge is commodified. Commodification of knowledge. That was his diagnosis of postmodern condition. Now, together with that diagnosis and together with these types of developments, a new outlook emerged. Instead of the Enlightenment approach to knowledge, where knowledge, science, and technology will be used for the benefit of society as a whole, and there will be progress. And this is one of the grand narrative. He calls this grand narrative, grand, great, big narrative, talking discourses, discourses about progress, about development, about controlling nature. And or for societal welfare. These were grand narratives of modernity. Even he calls them meta-narratives. Some of them are beyond universal narratives. But as knowledge and technology is commercialized, commodified, these grand narratives are fragmented. They are not anymore used by people. The knowledge is being bought and sold, commodified. How can we talk about humanity's development as a whole from to a more enlightened era, more equal and more freedom? He says that as knowledge is commodified and commercialized, parallel to it, these meta narratives, grand narratives, are given up, and instead of big theories, macro theories, universal theories, universal for all humanity, now people started having partial theories. One part of society in sociology, in social sciences, one part of society. You know, we can talk about one part of it, or maybe in another research, some other part. But these cannot be generalized into a general theory. Now, you will remember this from Foucault as well. Foucault was also critical of reason being in the center. So he contributed, Foucault contributed to removing reason from the center, because reason is not as it was expected in the grand narratives, and knowledge production, technology production, controlling and conquering nature, and distributing income that comes equally to people and liberating people. No, there was all this colonialism, imperialism, Second World War, Holocaust, etc. These contributed to the emergence of postmodern discourses, which are fragmented, partial, and hence scientific rational discourses open to competition from other discourses, other types of discourses. Let's think of in medicine, for example, there is experimental scientific biological based medicine, or alternative medicine, folk medicine. Now, in previous period, you cannot talk about as competing folk medicine or alternative medicine. Or there is astronomy, the science of astronomy. But you know, during that period, astrology, astrologists who are talking in newspapers, all over in televisions, you cannot think of them talking, putting discourses to the society, in front of society. But now, in televisions, especially you might have observed during the the New Year, what will happen in the year? So an astrologist comes to the television and talks authoritatively. That's what Lyotard saying. And Lyotard observed this during 1979. His book is published in 1979. So he diagnosed development of these alternative discourses 40 years ago. But now we observe it gradually, it seems. Now, I don't know whether this will continue, whether there will be another pendulum will swing in another direction. Again, from Bauman, you remember from Bauman when he's talking about security being security and freedom, how at one point freedom is given up for the sake of security, but another time security is given up for the sake of freedom, but then returning again, and that kind of thing. Maybe this the centeredness of scientific knowledge in astronomy versus astrology. Maybe there will be a period where scientific one will have more authority. For example, during this pandemic period, medicine, biology, and different branches of medicine gained some prestige. Instead of alternative medicine, now scientific biomedical model now came back. It became more forceful because we need scientific knowledge. Astrology doesn't help us, you know, that kind of a thing. Okay, now I think this was a major contribution of this postmodern condition. He has another book in 1982, which is translated into English, but not into Turkish, The Different, Phrases in Dispute. Now, Lyotard says that, like in the modern period, politics is not limited to the public sphere. It can be extended to private and subjective domains. So at every moment that people are making decisions in their subjective lives, in their private lives, and of course in objective public sphere, decisions are made politically. That is being accepted, you know, that is the prevalent condition. But Lyotard is saying that with postmodern condition, private sphere and subjective sphere is also being part of politics, political discussion. What he calls difference, different comes from difference. People conflicting with each other or debating, disputes, arguments, making arguments against each other. Now, Lyotard says that Society is made up by these disputes, by these difference. Different, if you ask me, what is the Turkish word for that? Not Turkish, but let me say an Ottoman word, ihtilaf, ihtilaf. That is not being agreeing with each other, differing with each other. But differing with each other is okay. But there is a different, Lyotard says, when the terms of conflict is formulated in the language of one side, in the language of one side, excluding the other side. Now, different, ihtilaf, emerges when in the debate, in the discussion, in the struggle between two parties, two groups, two people, two individuals. When the terms of the conflict, what is the conflict? What is the main issue in the conflict? If terms of the conflict is formulated in the language of one side, excluding the language of other side, excluding what are the objections of the other side, then it becomes different. This is the definition of different by Lyotard, and that is the title of the book, his book, Different. What he's saying is that language is not only an instrument of communication. Now, he says it is complex. It is formed by different regimes, by different regimes in different domains, in different fields. There is a complex, and it is not just communication, but you will remember from Bourdieu again that language is not neutral. Language can be used as a form of domination, status formation, inequality. And so here, Bourdieu and Foucault and Lyotard, they agree against whom? Against, let's say, Habermas, who treats language more as an instrument of communication, understanding, sharing meaning. Yes, there is sharing meaning, but not only sharing meaning, but also fighting, arguing, disputing. So he's keen to differences between people, different between groups, not only different people and different between groups, but also what he calls phrase regimes, various discourses, cultural discourses, artistic, aesthetic discourses, and scientific discourses. And classically institutionalized fields, domains. Now he calls them phrase regimes. What are they? Science, art, and literature. Now, the language, discourses of literature, of art, of painting, etc., and science, they are incommensurable. Now, incommensurability is one of the main concepts that Lyotard uses in order to describe postmodern condition. Incommensurability, incomparability. They are not comparable. regimes of science, art or literature, or as I gave example of alternative medicine and scientific medicine, they are incommensurable. They are talking about different diagnoses of an illness and different treatments. If you bring an alternative medicine person and a biomedical medicine model using a medical person, they will not agree. Their discourses are incommensurable, incommensurability of phrase regimes of science, art, and literature. But he says this incommensurability dominated French philosophy as well. Although they are in, now according to Lyotard, they are incommensurable, but I am trying to compare them. I am making them commensurable, although Lyotard says they are incommensurable. What are the incommensurable approaches in French philosophy? He says Derrida's deconstruction of writing and, for example, Foucault's disorder of discourse and Deleuze's nomadic encounter or Levinas's alterity. And these are, I just mentioned, four French philosophers, social scientists, who has four different approaches they developed. Now, Lyotard says they are incommensurable with each other. Although I think that, for example, today I will compare Lyotard and Deleuze. Now, actually, both think that politics is not only in the public sphere; it is on the also in the in, also in the subjective and private sphere. For example, Lyotard and Deleuze conventional, or I just compared Deleuze and Foucault, and I will do that now. Of course, they have different emphases. Sometimes it looks like incommensurable with each other, but our job as sociologists, as social scientists, looking for concepts to understand what is happening in the world, in the society, in our own societies, or in other societies, because what's happening in other societies are going to impact, going to influence our society as well. So when we are trying to understand these events, these developments, we have to use concepts from different approaches. That's why, you know, throughout this semester, I introduced you to so many approaches, so many theories, so many conceptual frameworks, so that when you encounter one phenomena, one fact or the other, you will remember, maybe this theorist's conceptual framework will help me to understand, to formulate a research problem and go to the field and do research and find out. That's why, you know, we are exposed, or I am exposing you, or as sociology department, we are talking about contemporary theories, all of them, as many as possible. Not all of them, of course. There are many more, of course. Some of them are for graduate study, for PhD or for Master of Science, Master of Arts. Anyway, I don't think that they are as incommensurable as Lyotard thinks, or at least I am trying to make them commensurable, comparable, so that we will benefit from the critical discussion of each, using one of them to criticize the other, and using that one to criticize this one. That's why I am asking you, you are going to write about the concepts of two sociologists, and then you will compare them, and then you will criticize one with the other. Now, so there are three people. When you write about two, there is a sociologist A, sociologist B, and yourself, sociologist C. So now you might directly criticize each of them, or you might criticize A by using concepts of B, or vice versa. You can criticize B by using concepts of A. So that from this discussion, a new knowledge will emerge, and you will be able to write a new proposition, a new statement, a new point of view, I hope. Okay, now, Lyotard has this concept of eruptions, again, happenings in the world, eruption. For example, today in or yesterday for America, yesterday there today, there was the new president being elected, but the supporters of the old president went and occupied in the White House, and this is or of the parliament where the new president was being ushered into his position, according to Lyotard, this is an eruption. This is a mass demonstration. Now, in the book, he's talking about mass demonstrations in Algeria. He was in Algeria, or mass demonstrations in Paris in 1968 events in Paris. Now, he says that these mass demonstrations cannot be explained easily with, for example, grand narratives of general historical forces. No, general historical macro explanations are not enough, or what he called the popular will. No, these are big concepts, grand concepts, grand narratives. We have to have a more specific research-based observations in order to explain them, to understand the specific causes in each event. We cannot generalize. Okay, no. In the postmodern condition, there is giving up of grand narratives and focusing on specific domains, areas, fields, and trying to understand the dynamics of that field. Remember from Bourdieu again, there are fields and subfields which are relatively autonomous, and in each field there's a different kind of capital and hence the different kinds of habitus. People will enter into that field and will fight or will struggle with each other, or they will be rivals, competition, etc. That is what Lyotard is talking about. Now, in terms of his criticism of the language as an instrument of communication, extends to his criticism of focusing on meaning, as usually done, on meaning. But instead of course, meaning is important. Society, people are made up by meanings. But he says, meaning, focusing on meaning is not enough. We have to focus on what the meaning does. What are the consequences? He says, what are the effective charge it contains, and what it causes to be done. This is his phrasing. So here, in a sense, this type of what the practice is a transformation of potential energies into something else. So what he's saying is, rather than remaining in the domain of criticism, he proposes going into minority affirmations, which leads to replacement of the cunning of reason. Cunning of reason is an Hegelian term. So he's saying that rational criticism in itself is not enough. We have to go into minorities instead of the whole society, but between the societies, minorities. Now, these minorities might be artistic minorities, ethnic minorities, religious minorities, political minorities. Instead of focusing on grand narrative consensuses, which does not exist, he said, anymore, we have to focus on, he says, a thousand little stories, thousands of uncomfortable little stories of the minorities. A minority, minorities are in a critically marginalized situation. If we look at the general aspect of society, instead of looking at the general aspect only, focusing only on that, but he says we have to focus on minority. Now, we will see a similar proposal by Deleuze and Guattari in a minute. We will go into that. So this is a commensurability between Lyotard and Deleuze Guattari, actually. So instead of master narratives or grand narratives, Lyotard asks for thousands of uncomfortable little stories. And he is critical of museums. If you remember, Bourdieu was also, Bourdieu conducted a research on museum visiting. And what is the meaning of museum visiting? He has a book, Love of Art, and how culture, like language, is not neutral, or museum visiting is not neutral, and how different classes, different minorities in Lyotard's terminology, goes into different museums, or do not go into museums. Anyway, he says, instead of endless museification of culture, he is against museification, müzeleştirme, museification of culture, and hence, enhancing memory. But Lyotard thinks that this museification of culture and enhance contributing in to collective memory, he criticizes this, actually, because he thinks that capitalism uses memory, this museification, for the extension of commodification. Now, in museums, okay, they are museified, but in the market, they are commodified. So he brings our attention to this parallel of museification and commodification. Okay, I think this is my summary of Lyotard's approach. Anyway, I am not claiming that I am not claiming that I will give all the concepts, review of all the books of each theorist that I am taking up. I am just making an introduction, a familiarity. You will be familiar, and maybe you will do your own research, and we learn more about it whenever you need it. Whenever you need it, that is the point. So now I will go to our next theorist. Actually, theorists with us, because they are two friends doing research together or writing books together, Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari. Now, Gilles Deleuze is a philosopher. Félix Guattari is a psychiatrist. Okay. But these are not an ordinary philosopher, Gilles Deleuze, and Félix Guattari is not an ordinary psychiatrist. Actually, he's an anti-psychiatrist. Now, his occupation is psychiatry, but he's anti-psychiatrist. He's against psychiatry, actually. He's or critical of psychiatry and critical of not only medical psychiatry, where medicines are being used, but also depth psychoanalysis, Freudian or Lacanian or other, critical of them. Although he is also in the circles of Lacanian psychoanalysis, but together with Gilles Deleuze, Félix Guattari developed a new type of approach to understanding child's development, people's development, emergence of various social formations, instead of a structured society. They conceptualized a more fragmented type of society, and they are actually they are proposing, instead of using the concept of society, which is structural. Now the prevalent concept of society, the concept of society, is structure, is formulated from a structuralist point of view. Now, Deleuze and Guattari is proposing an alternative terminology, assemblage. Now, it is translated into Turkish as öbekleşme. There is a book I have here, Manuel Dolanda's book. Let me see whether you see this book, this Manuel Dolanda's book. Now, it says a new philosophy of society, but under subtitle is assemblages and social complexity. Now, in Turkish, öbekleşme teorisi ve toplumsal karmaşıklık. öbekleşme, öbekleşme. Now, they say that assemblage, öbek, öbek, assemblages, öbekler, a society made up of öbekler, kümelenmeler, assemblages and multitudes. They use these two concepts, assemblages and multitudes. And these assemblages and multitudes are not structured in the classical tree, like conceptualizing tree, but they are in a way of rhizome. Okay, now, this arborescent and rhizomatic, rhizomatic, two contrasting approaches. Now, the first chapter of their second book, A Thousand Plateaus, which is published in 1987, as a sequel, actually, to a book which they published in 1977. Now, the first one was Anti-Oedipus, Capitalism and Schizophrenia. Now, this second book, A Thousand Plateaus, again, subtitle is same, Capitalism and Schizophrenia. Plateau, in Turkish, yayla. Now, that they conceptualize now, plateau, they use plateau where various now they use again their terminology, territorialization and re-territorialization of different groups, individuals, forces take place, and then maybe it shifts to another plateau. For example, they propose that you know, in this A Thousand Plateaus, there are, each chapter is a plateau, and they say that you can read each chapter or each plateau independently of the other, except the last chapter, which they propose it should be read after reading all other chapters. Now, okay, now let me begin. What are the basic concept, basic strategy of their approach? They say that 2,000 years of Western philosophy used a tree analogy, and they call that arborescent. Arborescent is ağaçlı, ağaçta yaşayanlar. Arborescent species are species living in trees. Arborescent. Now, knowledge in this approach is thought of like a tree. Think of a tree, and the main trunk of the tree. This is ancient philosophy. Philosophy in Greece or in Rome. And then from this philosophy emerging branches of medicine, law, theology. Now Kant talks about four faculties or four main approaches. So philosophy becomes one, then where at the beginning it was combined together, and then it divides into philosophy, medicine, law or jurisprudence, and medicine. And then this is the pre-modern era. And then in the modern era, philosophy again divides into natural sciences, humanities and social sciences. Natural sciences, these are all branches, a big branch, another branch. Natural sciences, that was a branch of that tree, natural sciences, into physics, into biology, into chemistry, into so many other natural sciences, dividing and disciplines. Tree of knowledge. This is a tree of knowledge. Or social sciences, dividing into psychology, sociology, anthropology, history, economic, and then sociology is divided into 55-60 sub-branches. These are all branches. Now, for 2,000 years, Western philosophy, Western thinking, Western approach used this tree image. Now, he says, they say, now let's give up using tree image. Okay, we gained so much knowledge with that analogy. But now let's think of our research, our scientific domains, or humanities or social sciences in a rhizomatic way. What is a rhizomatic plant instead of an arborescent, okay, trees on the one side and rhizomes on the other side? What are rhizomes? Rhizome is, for example, okay, let me give coach grass. Now, you don't know this, of course, if you are not particularly interested in grasses, but it is ayrık otu, or tubers like yumrular, potatoes and other plants, where they are on the ground and they spread instead of like a tree growing up having a trunk and the branches. No, they multiply. They are related to each other with a weak connection, whereas in a tree, branches are connected to the trunk, to the main body. You cannot separate them. If you separate them, that will die. Whereas in ayrık otu, it is actually for farmers, ayrık otu, if there's an ayrık otu in a field, they will have difficulty cleaning it, because if you take out one part of ayrık otu, if there is another part, it will emerge again, and then it will give rise to another one, to another one, to another one. you will never be able to get rid of ayrık otu from your field. Or potatoes, or bulbs, çiçek soğanı, tulips, for example, tulip bulbs. Now you put them on the ground, they give rise to new ones, they multiply. Now, especially in potatoes, you can see that you put one potatoes, it becomes so many potatoes, and if you don't take them, they will give to another so many other potatoes, and so many other potatoes. The whole field will be filled with potatoes, or filled with coach grass. Now, these are rhizomatic assemblages of plants, of rhizomatic assemblages, and they are connected to each other, but they say they are connected to each other in a rhizomatic way. And they are multitudes that are connected to each other in a rhizomatic way. They are not structurally determining each other. they have relative autonomy from each other. Relative autonomy is much stronger. Remember from your second year, Althusser, determination of, for example, political structure, cultural structures, by the economic structure, determination. But instead of determination in Althusser, it is determination in last instance, because political, juridical, ideological structures are relatively autonomous, relative autonomous, that is making them relative autonomous variables or levels. But here in Deleuze and Guattari, this relative autonomy is extended further, almost if we think of this autonomy on the one hand, autonomy here and determination here as two ends, and in absolute autonomy. So every part is independent of each other. No, that is then there is no assemblage in that case. Now, for there should be a society, the families cannot be totally autonomous from each other or individuals. Because why? Because they need each other. They have to help children grow, because if children are not grown by the adults, children will die. A human species is such species. So they need each other. But needing each other is, what is the degree of dependence to each other? Now, in the structuralist approach, they are 100% dependent. They determine each other. There is no autonomy. In Althusser, there is some autonomy or relative autonomy. Now in Deleuze and Guattari, this relative autonomy is further extended, and hence it's a rhizomatic autonomy, a rhizomatic assemblage and multitude. Now, for example, I have taken an example from A Thousand Plateaus. Now, you know, orchid, orchid, a flower, orchide. Now, think of orchid flower, very colorful orchid flower. Why orchid is being opened? So that bees, wasps will come and will get some honey, something from the orchid flower for its needs. But in the meantime, wasp will contribute to reproduction of the orchids, because that is, the bees are necessary for fertilization or reproduction of plants. Now, they say that orchid and the wasp form an assemblage, an rhizomatic assemblage. Now, they use here two concepts. Now, I already use arborescent, tree-like, and rhizomatic, tree and ayrı kotu, or couch grass. Assemblage is plants or insects or different species forming an assemblage, forming a rhizomatic being together. Now, they introduce two terms, which is being used by other theorists, the sociology books that you read. This is territorialization and deterritorialization. Now, this is a difficult concept, term in English. It is translated into Turkish, yersiz yurtsuzlaştırma ve the opposite, re-territorialization, or territorialization is being placed in a place. Territorialization, yerli yurtlu hale getirme, yerleştirme. De-territorialization, yersiz yurtsuzlaştırma. Now this is the sentence. This is a sentence from A Thousand Plateaus. The orchid deterritorializes by forming an image. Think of orchid flower, the image of orchid flower, beautiful. And the wasp, the bee, re-territorializes, yerleşiyor. The orchid deterritorializes, opens up. The wasp re-territorializes on that image. The wasp is now deterritorialized by becoming a part of the reproductive cycle of the orchid, But now it is deterritorialized because it goes to another orchid, but it re-territorializes the orchid by transporting its pollen. This is pollinization between plants, pollinization. So wasp and orchid, now these are two heterogeneous elements, two different species, but they form a rhizome, they say. They form a rhizome. Now, it could be said that the orchid imitates the wasp, reproducing its image in a signifying fashion, and making so that wasp comes to this orchid, not to that orchid. Whichever orchid is more similar to the wasp colors, something like that. But they say, no, no, this is not true, they say. Or it is true on the only on the level of strata. Okay, they use another term, strata. You know strata from your class and stratification class, social class and stratification. Strata are tabaka. Okay. Now, wasp and orchid are two species, so they are in two different strata. So there is an aparallelism, not parallelism, but aparallelism between two strata, such that plant organization on one strata imitates an animal organization on the other. At the same time, something else is entirely going on. Not imitation at all, but a capture, yakalama, a capture of code, of surplus value of code, an increase in valence, a very becoming. Now, and there's another Deleuzian concept, becoming. Now, the orchid is in the process of becoming wasp, becoming like a wasp, like a bee, becoming wasp of the orchid, and becoming orchid of the wasp, becoming a process. Each of these becomings brings about a deterritorialization one term and re-territorialization of the other. This is okay. Now this is a kind of analysis they carry out throughout this book, and I reproduced it here. You can read it here. It is in the content part of the blackboard. And so the two becomings interlink and form relays in a circulation of intensities, pushing deterritorialization even further. So here, there is neither imitation nor resemblance, only an exploding of two heterogeneous series on a line of flight composed by a common rhizome that can no longer be attributed to or subjugated to anything signifying. Okay, so two heterogeneous species, orchid and wasp, and how their becomings form a series on the line of flight. So another Deleuzian concept, Deleuzian, and I should combine Guattarian, Deleuzian, Guattarian, flight, lines of flight, escape, flight or escape, and they use this concept. Now, actually, then they go on, and they choose another analogy, and the analogy is very much on the agenda this year, in the year of pandemia. Now, as we know, this pandemic is caused by a virus. Now, this virus actually was inhabiting in another animal. Animal. There are debates about what type of animal that was, whatever. But somehow, from that animal, so that animal, then that virus, they say, form a rhizome. Now they are two different species, like wasp and the orchid, but they are together. They form an entity, a something, and then of course there are mutations. There is an evolution taking place. Mutation is an evolution. Evolution. So evolutionary, the up parallel evolution of two beings, up parallel evolution of orchid and the wasp, or up parallel evolution of the virus and the host, virus and the host, up parallel evolution of two beings that have absolutely nothing to do with each other, actually, but then they have to do with each other because virus causes such an illness in the host. So more generally, evolutionary schemas may be forced to abandon the old model of tree and descent. In the tree or genesis, under and descent, coming from descending, descending. Under certain conditions, a virus can connect to germ cells and transmit itself as the cellular gene of a complex species. For example, a baboon or another type of monkey, or eventually comes into human beings. It can take flight, move into the cells of an entirely different species, but not without bringing with it a genetic information from the first host, from the first host. And here they give examples of Benveniste and Todaro's research on a type C virus, type C virus, which is for which there is no vaccination. There is no vaccination. The evolutionary schemes of the viruses would no longer follow models of arborescent descent going from the least to the most differentiated, least, because they are not differentiated. They are mutating. They are not differentiating. They are not being developing into a new species. No, they are mutating. Differentiate, but instead a rhizome operating immediately in the heterogeneous and jumping from one already differentiated line to another, jumping into another. We form a rhizome with our viruses. We form a rhizome with our viruses, or rather, our viruses cause us to form a rhizome with other animals. From whichever animal this virus came, COVID, coronavirus, virus, coronavirus came. So instead of studying structures or discourses or assemblages, in a genealogical way, like Foucault did, or in an archaeological way. These are two contrasting methodologies approaches that Foucault used. Now, Deleuze and Guattari are using an anti-genealogical approach, because they say rhizome, this is again a sentence from A Thousand Plateaus, the rhizome is an anti-genealogy. Rhizome is an anti-genealogy. Actually, here I might tell you a story about Foucault and Deleuze. They were very good friends in the earlier years, but when Foucault published his The Birth of Prison, Deleuze wrote a criticism of the book. Now, in earlier times, they were writing reviews, critical reviews of each other's books. But somehow, this criticism in this book, and especially his criticism of the second volume of History of Sexuality, the title of which is about pleasure, the uses of pleasure. This is Foucault's book. Deleuze, in the review, said that it could have been better, Michel Foucault, if you used, instead of pleasure, desire. And desire is a more general affect, if you want to explain pathologies or health of human personalities, human relationships, etc. Now, is it pleasure or desire? For example, in the criticism of psychoanalysis, this will, I think, exemplify how they differ from, for example, this is an example, psychoanalytic approach. Unlike psychoanalysis and psychoanalytic competence, they propose schizoanalysis, and they say that unlike psychoanalysis, schizoanalysis rejects any idea of pre-traced destiny. Destiny, now again, genealogical destiny, from this to that, from that to this, the stages, but the one stage giving rise to the second stage. the development of child from one stage to another stage. So instead of looking at it in an in a tree where arborescent way or genetic genealogical way, drives and part objects are neither stages on a genetic axis nor positions in a deep structure. Okay, so they are against this genetic dimension where there are stages, genetic genesis stages, genetical stages, or in a structuralist approach, there are positions in deep structure. What are they? They are political options for problems. They are entryways and exits. So the other terminology that they use when they are analyzing plateaus, into a plateaus there are entryways and there are exits, entryways and exits. So instead of psychoanalyzing a child's genetic stages, it can be looked at how child leaves out politically their difficulties, and with the force of his or her desire. So here, desire is as a central concept, which is against the pleasure, the central concept of Foucault. Now, this reminds me a story, or a film, actually. Maybe many of you watched this film, Neşeli Günler, Joyful Days, where Münir Özkul and Adile Naşit, wife and husband, and they have six children, and they are producing cucumber, okay, or cabbage kind of to eat it and to fermenting cabbage with vinegar or with lemon. One says with vinegar. Remember this movie? The other says no, with lemon. And they separate from each other. They have two different places where they produce. They do this fermentation, and their children grow up, and then they discover each other. They never come together. So it was like that between Foucault and Deleuze. Towards the end, in 1984, when Foucault was hospitalized, Deleuze wanted to see him, to visit him, but Foucault didn't want this visitation. It seems he was offended with Deleuze's criticism of his two books, that he has written during his last phase. Okay, now let me come back and finish Deleuze and Guattari. They formulate axes, dimensions. So they say that assemblages, rhizomatic assemblages, or the Turkish word öbekleşmeler, assemblages, are composed of discursive and non-discursive components. Now, this was also in Foucault, how discursive and non-discursive components are brought together. Actually, in Foucault's terminology, it was dispositives of knowledge and power being combined in dispositive. Whereas in Deleuze and Guattari, they are combined, or discursive and non-discursive are combined in assemblages. So this is one dimension. The second dimension, movements that govern their operation, the movements they now, constitution of fields and territories. Now the field or territory is similar to Bourdieu's fields and subfields. Now here there is interiority versus deterritorialization and lines of flight or exit, flight or exit. So they think that there are a kind of abstract machines that inhabit the assemblages, like their virtual double, as if there is a virtual machine. But this virtual machine is not a rational structure where everything is determined. I think there is a similarity here. Anthony Giddens's duality of structure, if you remember, structure is virtual, and that virtual structure, rules and resources, are used while acting. This virtual is a medium of action where action is being produced and structure is reproduced. Okay, maybe some Deleuzians will object to this analogy between this abstract machine concept, but they say that these abstract machines are that inhabit assemblages are like virtual double. Virtual double, and hence what happens is lines of deterritorialization, the action of the assemblages are deterritorialized and reterritorialized. Now in terms of how they are in terms of in at one and absolute, the other and relative, negative or positive, negative being subject to reterritorialization, deterritorialization and then reterritorialization. Okay, and here the last concept, majority minority, or becoming minor or minoritarian. Remember from Lyotard, he was saying that instead of macro structures, narratives, we have to look at minority points of view. And Deleuze and Guattari is saying the same thing. Actually, it is not just looking and observing minority perspective, but becoming minority, or the process of minoritarianization, becoming minor, minor groups, or becoming like a child in order to understand a child's perspective, instead of a dominant conceptualization of the state or the authority. They are very critical of total structures, like Foucault. Remember, Foucault also conceptualized power as between two people, spreading in networks, instead of one hierarchical structure. Now, Deleuze and Guattari has a chapter on war machines and on nomads. Genghis Khan. Now, Genghis Khan's nomadic organization is conceptualized as a war machine. It's not a machine, of course, but it acts like, you know, it's a mobile nomadic organization. Now, instead of a state-like hierarchical organization, a nomadic organization, purely, and there's an entire chapter on this, and there are pages and pages. They analyze not only the Turco-Mongolian formations during 13th, 14th, 15th centuries, and also anthropological data about pre-state tribes and how they form non-hierarchical rhizome type nomadic organizations, assemblages. So they actually privilege nomads against the settled populations. Now they say for thousands of years, philosophy, social sciences looked at the life from the perspective of the settlement, stability and settlement. But this new world that we are entering is not any more stable or settled. It is becoming more and more nomadic. Now remember here Bauman, uncertainty and nomadicness of, at least from the point of view of Bauman, of course, capital and tourists become nomadic, unfortunately, whereas labor are local, cannot move. But if they were able to move, perhaps there will be more equality. Now, Deleuze and Guattari is advocating nomadic mobility for all classes, all groups, through these territorialization and deterritorializations and reterritorializations, there will be perhaps more free and democratic assemblages in the world. Okay, maybe I can stop here and let me ask whether you have any